welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, John Russell tells us how U.S. technology companies are securing energy supplies from Bitcoin miners. Bryan Lynn has this week's science report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
U.S. technology companies are increasingly purchasing or leasing energy assets held by Bitcoin miners. These moves come as technology companies hurry to secure a supply of electricity for their growing artificial intelligence, or AI, and cloud computing data centers. Those data centers are driving the fastest increase in U.S. electricity demand since 2000. The demand is growing faster than the electricity grid. That means big technology companies, like Amazon and Microsoft, are aiming to secure large amounts of electricity. Growing power demand is affecting the cryptocurrency mining industry, an industry that uses a lot of energy. Some miners are making a profit by leasing or selling their power-connected infrastructure and centers. But other miners cannot get enough electricity to stay in business. Greg Beard is chief of Stronghold Digital Mining, a publicly traded Bitcoin mining company based in Pennsylvania. The AI battle for dominance is a battle being had by the biggest and best capitalized companies in the world, and they care like their lives depend on it that they win, he said. Do they care about what they pay for power? Probably not. Electric Power Research Institute is a nonprofit energy research company based in Palo Alto, California. It said in May that data centers could use up to 9% of total electricity produced in the U.S. by 2030. That is more than double their current use. This change comes as technology companies are paying a lot to grow their computing centers. The International Energy Agency, or IEA, says that data centers currently account for about 1 to 1.3% of world electricity use. Crypto mining uses 0.4%. The IEA says that difference is expected to grow. Experts expect 20% of Bitcoin mining power capacity to move to AI by the end of 2027. Over the past year, Bitcoin miners have increasingly competed with AI data center owners for the same power production centers and business deals. That is what heads of more than 6 publicly traded U.S. crypto mining companies told Reuters. One example took place in Pennsylvania. Marathon Digital Holdings is the world's biggest publicly traded Bitcoin miner. Two sources who know about the situation said the company was among those considering a nuclear-powered data center owned by Talon Energy in Pennsylvania. But technology company Amazon bought the center in a deal announced in March. Many large miners that own land and are connected to power centers are changing the way they do business. They are marketing their property and energy services to AI and cloud computing companies and doing less crypto mining. We've gotten a lot of interest from everyone from an Amazon or Google, said Carrie Longley. He is an official for Bitcoin miner TerraWolf. The company has a center in New York that can produce 770 megawatts of electricity. Core Scientific is a crypto miner that a court recently permitted to restructure after its earlier financial failure. In June, Core Scientific became the first Bitcoin miner to announce a major agreement. The deal was to lease its power-connected production centers to the company CoreWeave, which is supported by NVIDIA. The deals are estimated to be worth more than $6.7 billion over 12 years. Several miners have since said they would lease or act as subcontractors to develop AI data centers. Morgan Stanley said providing electricity for AI and cloud computing could be profitable for big crypto miners. The investment bank said it could make their centers as much as 5 times more valuable. Morgan Stanley also said technology companies could save billions of dollars by buying or leasing space from a miner with at least 100 megawatts of electricity production. It said such deals could cut the wait times for a data center to launch by about 3.5 years. I'm John Russell.
A private space mission will seek to launch non-astronauts to a high orbit and include the first private spacewalks in history. The American space company SpaceX's flight is cleared to launch from Florida's Kennedy Space Center beginning September 7th. The American space agency, NASA, operates the center. The exact launch date will depend on weather conditions. American businessman Jared Isaacman organized and paid for the mission called Polaris Dawn. He and 3 people will crew the mission. Isaacman is the head of payment processing company Shift for Payments. He has an estimated personal worth of $2 billion, but he has not said publicly how much he paid SpaceX for the Polaris Dawn mission. The crew members will travel in SpaceX's Crew Dragon spacecraft on a SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket. The company expects the spacecraft to reach an altitude of about 1,400 kilometers. That would be the highest any crewed mission has reached since NASA's Apollo program ended in the early 1970s. Isaacman is the mission commander for Polaris Dawn. Also taking part in the flight will be Scott Poteet, a retired U.S. Air Force colonel, and 2 SpaceX employees, Sarah Gillis and Anna Menon. Gillis is a mission specialist at SpaceX, while Menon is a lead space operations engineer. The crew is expected to spend 5 days in orbit. Polaris Dawn will reach its highest altitude on its first day. The Crew Dragon will briefly enter the Van Allen Radiation Belt, an area filled with high-energy charged particles that can present health risks to humans over extended periods. This will provide a chance to test the effectiveness of SpaceX's newly designed spacesuits. SpaceX says the clothing is equipped with data instruments, cameras, and improved mobility systems. SpaceX says tests of the spacesuit will help the company design and develop future space missions to the Moon and Mars. A statement by SpaceX said one main goal of Polaris Dawn will be to carry out research with the aim of better understanding the effects of spaceflight and space radiation on human health. Speaking about the mission's risks, Isaacman told reporters, "Whatever risk is associated with it, it is worth it." He added, "We have no idea what it could do to really change the trajectory of humankind. There has to be some first steps in this direction." The crew will orbit nearly 3 times higher than the International Space Station, ISS. But this is far short of the record-breaking distance of over 399,117,000 kilometers set by NASA's Apollo 13 crew in 1970. Isaacman is expected to guide the other crew members on the mission's planned spacewalk on day 3 of the mission. Each member is expected to spend about 20 minutes in space. So far, only government astronauts from the U.S., former Soviet Union and Russia, the European Space Agency, Canada, and China have carried out spacewalks. More than 270 spacewalks using American and Russian spacesuits have been carried out from the ISS since its launch in 2000, Reuters news agency reports. The next day will be spent testing laser-based satellite communication between the spacecraft and Starlink, SpaceX's internet satellite system. The laser method, which has also been tested by NASA, is designed to greatly increase space communication speeds. The crew also plans to carry out 40 experiments aimed at improving our understanding of human health during long space missions. Among these will be tests with special contact lenses containing microelectronics that can continuously identify changes in eye pressure and shape. At the end of the mission, Crew Dragon will aim for a parachute landing off the coast of Florida. A SpaceX recovery ship will be waiting for the crew's arrival. Polaris Dawn is the first of 3 planned missions under the Polaris program. The second Polaris mission will also use a Dragon capsule, while the third and final is expected to use SpaceX's Starship rocket. SpaceX chief Elon Musk has said his company plans to use Starship to carry future space travelers to the Moon and Mars. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Now, Bryan Lynn is here to talk about his science report. Thanks for joining me today, Bryan.
Sure, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
This week, you reported on a private space mission that is expected to include the first spacewalk by non-astronauts in history. We learned in the report that this mission is being led by SpaceX. But how did it actually come about?
So the idea for this mission, called Polaris Dawn, came from billionaire businessman Jared Isaacman. He is also the one leading this spaceflight, and Isaacman took part in another SpaceX flight 3 years ago that became the first trip to carry an all-civilian crew into low Earth orbit. That flight was a 3-day trip that orbited Earth, but no spacewalks took place. So really, after that successful flight, Isaacman immediately began planning another, but this time to travel farther with civilians than ever before. And this also led to the idea to include spacewalks as well.
We also learned from the report that this civilian crew will also complete a series of experiments. What can you tell us about that?
Yes, it seems the crew will be busy during their planned 5-day mission, and the main focus of these experiments will be on how human health can be affected by the effects of long-term space travel. Since this mission will take the crew so far from Earth, the risk for radiation exposure increases. And the report mentioned that the spacesuits the crew will be wearing were completely redesigned for this mission. They are, of course, built to protect humans from the effects of radiation, for example, but since it will be the first time these suits will be tested in this kind of environment, the team expects to learn a lot about their effectiveness and identify changes that need to be made.
Okay, thanks again for joining me, Bryan, and thank you for answering those questions.
You're welcome, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
My name is Anna Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Anna has recently moved to Washington, D.C. It is a new experience for her. She is excited to live in the capital of the United States, but she also misses her hometown and family, who live many hours away.
Let's hear Anna talk about that with her friend Marcia in Lesson 12 of Let's Learn English. Listen carefully for the expression Anna uses for the feeling of missing home.
Hello. Washington, D.C. has many beautiful parks. In fact, this park reminds me of my home, very far away.
Anna, here's your coffee.
Thanks, Marcia.
What's wrong?
I'm thinking about my family. I'm feeling homesick.
Ah, yes, feeling homesick. I've had that feeling a few times in my life. It's a feeling that can sometimes be difficult.
I agree. I think feeling homesick is more than just missing your home and family a little bit. It's something that hits you much more strongly.
That's right. I think a good word to describe it is yearning. That's spelled Y-E-A-R-N-I-N-G. A yearning is a noun and means a strong desire for something, often for something that you can't reach. And the verb form of this word is to yearn for.
And another word that means the same thing is longing. We can say we have a longing for something we strongly desire, but that we can't have or can't reach. And the verb form of this word is to long for.
So, if you long for home, it means you miss it a lot. And that's feeling homesick. Have you ever felt homesick, Jill?
Yeah, one summer I was working in China, in Chengdu. I was getting kind of homesick, and while I was walking around the city, I ran into this cute little cafe that was just like an American coffee shop. I ordered a drink and sat down and saw they were even playing American videos on their TV. I started talking with the owner, and I felt much less homesick. It was like a little bit of the U.S. in the middle of Chengdu.
Yeah, well, that makes sense. I think when you get to see something familiar with your own home culture, that will help you feel less homesick. And, you know, it's also interesting that even a positive thing, like the parks in Washington, D.C., can make Anna homesick.
That's because they remind her of home. Let's listen to Anna say that one more time.
Hello. Washington, D.C. has many beautiful parks. In fact, this park reminds me of my home, very far away.
Jill, remind me to tell our listeners what podcast they are listening to.
Okay, I'll remind you now. Andrew, remember to tell our listeners what podcast they're listening to.
You're listening to the Learning English Podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
In English, we remind someone to do something. But a thing can remind us of something else.
That's right. People learning English need to remember to include the preposition of. So the order of words to follow is remind plus the person plus the preposition of.
Like, remind him of, remind her of, remind them of. Or, remind Anna of, remind Jill of, remind someone of.
That's right. The word also has a noun form. For that, we say a reminder. A reminder is something we use to help us remember.
Like reminders on your phone.
Right. I have to put everything on my phone to remember it nowadays. My phone is my memory.
So you would be really lost if you lost your phone.
No, I think I'd take a vacation.
Well, also, a reminder can simply be something we see or experience that makes us remember or think about something. And if it's a very negative reminder, we have a special expression. We say, a sober reminder of something.
Can you give an example, Andrew?
Sure. When we see a bad car accident, that is a sober reminder of how dangerous it can be to drive.
In this case, the word sober means serious and causing worry.
So, Jill, coming back to the topic of feeling homesick, do you have any advice for how people can deal with it?
I think if people keep themselves busy and get involved with people in their new place, they will usually feel less homesick. You'll probably find that the people are just as nice there as the people back home. And the good thing about homesickness is that it usually doesn't last too long. After a while, it wears off.
That's true. It does wear off, which means it disappears after a certain amount of time. I remember that once I felt really homesick for just a few hours, but then only a day or two later, the feeling was mostly gone.
Yeah, sometimes homesickness can wear off quickly.
However, if someone continues to yearn for home or long for home for a long time, we could say they have chronic homesickness.
Ah, yeah. Chronic, spelled C-H-R-O-N-I-C, describes something that lasts for a very long time and keeps happening again and again. In that case, it doesn't wear off.
I'm Andrew Smith, and you're listening to the Learning English Podcast. Jill, we should explain to our listeners that the phrasal verb wear off can be used for both physical objects and for what we feel inside.
Oh, yeah. For example, the paint on a car can slowly wear off over many years, especially if it has been sitting in the sun. But the phrasal verb wear off is used more for things like feelings or for the effects of food or medicine.
Like the effect of a drug wears off over time.
And the best cure for homesickness is to visit home. And depending on your family, you just might be happy to travel again afterwards.
We do love our families. And when Anna talked about feeling homesick, she shared photos of her family with Marcia. Several times, Marcia asked Anna to explain a bit about what her family members do. Let's listen.
This is my mother, and this is my father. They are rodeo clowns.
What do rodeo clowns do?
They make jokes at a rodeo. People laugh.
That's very different. Who is that woman in the picture?
That is my Aunt Lavender. She is my mom's sister. She loves gardening and makes spoons.
She makes spoons?
Of course.
That, too, is very different.
Oh, this is my Uncle John. He is my father's brother.
What does Uncle John do?
He's a chicken farmer and makes guitars. He's awesome, and I'm his favorite niece.
Who are they?
They are my cousins. They are my Uncle John's daughter and son.
What do they do?
They raise sheep and make sweaters.
That's some family she has there. In American culture, asking about what kind of work people do is very common. At a social gathering, when Americans first meet a new person, often one of the first questions they ask is, "What do you do?" or "What kind of work do you do?"
That's right. Sometimes Americans will talk about their job first and then talk about where they are from or about their family.
I guess Americans really like their jobs.
Well, maybe. Or maybe they just like talking about them. For some reason, it's just one of the first things Americans usually talk about when they meet new people.
That sounds like something a cultural anthropologist could tell us more about.
Yeah, I think so, because anthropologists study human culture.
That gives me an idea for a guest we could invite to our podcast.
I was just thinking the same thing. But even if we can't find a cultural anthropologist, there are still a lot of things our listeners can learn about American language and culture in the series Let's Learn English.
That's right. And we hope you've enjoyed today's lesson on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.